Welcome to Candid Conversation number 13. This one, we're going to talk about how Christians act and how it really hurts their ability to share the gospel and to lead others into the knowledge of the truth. First, what we should look at is basically what a Christian is. A Christian is someone who has recognized that they're a sinner, that they cannot work their way to heaven, and they trust in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for their sins. They then receive the indwelling Holy Spirit. The indwelling Holy Spirit is given to teach you the things of God. So as you read your Bible, as you listen to a sermon, as you read something about Scripture, you let the Holy Spirit teach you, you know, is this right or is this not right? You know, am I what a pastor would say or a commentary would say? And then when you read the Bible, of course, the Bible is true, so you can believe it all, but it's the Holy Spirit teaches you what it means. And then, with that doctrine, then, it's built up your strength and with might in the inner man, Ephesians 3:16. And you use that doctrine to make decisions in life. How you act with people, how you, you know, what job you take, where you live, just all these things. It's not that God supernaturally tells you, you should live here, you should take this job, but it's just all the decisions you make in life are based upon the doctrine that's built up in the inner man rather than upon your emotions. And so then, based on those decisions, people can see Christ living in you, Galatians 2:20, so that they may be saved, or if they're already saved, come into the knowledge of the truth. That's how God has designed it. But what you see Christians doing, though, is the opposite. First off, most people think, even people who call themselves Christians, they think that being a Christian means going to church on Sunday, dressing up, going to church on Sunday, and talking like a Christian. Like, oh, the Lord told me this. The Lord led me this way. I just feel in my spirit that God wants me to do this. And then going to church is feeling the presence of the Lord and feeling good about yourself. Or getting rid of some guilt that you had and now, you know, crying it out before the Lord and feeling the Lord in the worship service. Like, the Lord is now with me and I am in His presence. That's what Christians think that Christianity is all about. Now, if they've never believed the gospel, then they're not a Christian. They don't have the Holy Spirit. They still take on God's name by going to church and proclaiming God, but they can't act like a Christian. They cannot lead others to be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth because they themselves are not saved. But laying those aside, which is probably most people who go to church fall in that category, but putting that aside and let's assume that the person is saved. They truly are a Christian. They have recognized that they're a sinner and they trusted in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection alone and not any works that they do or any, you know, acts of feeling sorry or confessing their sins. They've trusted in what Jesus did alone as atonement for their sins. Then you look at how they act, though. They still act in a fleshly manner. I've talked to people who work at restaurants as waitresses, and they say that they hate working on Sundays. That's the least favorite because people come in after church, and there are two things wrong with these people. First off, they act uppity. They act like they're better than everybody else. And second, they don't tip that well. So you got to put up with their bad behavior and you end up getting less money for it than if you had somebody who was not a Christian come in and you know, they give you, act a little nicer and they give you a better tip. Sorry about that, this camera moved a little bit. Okay, so that's the problem. And the problem with that behavior is that what it does is it, people don't want to be saved. They don't want to come into the knowledge of the truth. When unbelievers look at Christians, they should look at them as different, as having the love of Christ shed abroad in their hearts to them. They should look at them as being, you know, more loving, more caring, more giving, better people overall than the rest of the world, because they've allowed the Holy Spirit and the doctrine that He teaches them to transform their lives, their way of thinking, such that they're not out to please the flesh, but they're thinking about how to serve others, how to be that ambassador for Christ, how to show God's love to others. But the problem is, they go to church and then they feel the presence of the Lord, supposedly, or whatever they feel there. So then they come out. Well, there are a couple things that are involved here. First, they feel superior than everybody else because they dressed up, they took time out of their schedule, they got the kids ready and dragged them to church, and so they did a good deed that the people at the restaurant did not do. You know, in their mind, this is what they're thinking, and that good deed is they went to church and they endured the pastor's message and they sat through all of that, and so that makes them somehow better people. So then when they go to church, when they leave church and they go out to a restaurant or wherever they go, now they act like they're better than everybody else. That, you know, look at me. In fact, when they come in, you can see them right away. Now, today you don't see that as much. You don't see people dressing up as much for church as you did before. But still today, a lot of times you can identify the church people. They're coming into your restaurant. You know, in other words, by them dressing up, they already try to set themselves apart from everybody else by looking better than them. You know, look at me. I just came from church. I'm a holy person. And then when they're actually sitting down and, you know, for the meal, well, now they act like they're better than everybody else because, you know, I went to church, I sacrificed, I endured the pastor's message, and I had sat through all that, while you were just working at a lowly job here as a waitress. Never mind the fact that being a waitress is actually a much better way of serving the Lord or being an example to others if you allow Christ's love to come through you. Then going to church, because there are so many people you interact with, unbelievers, who can see that. Putting that aside, but Christians think that they're somehow better than everybody else because they attended church. So there's that attitude, that snobbish attitude that I'm better than everybody else. And then the second part of it about them not paying a good tip, well, that comes from what the pastor just did, because the pastor just spent half an hour trying to guilt them into giving a bunch of money in the offering. Oh, we got this building fund. You know, you need to give to the building fund to support the ministry. God's work will go away if you don't give. And you got to give the tithe. You know, what will a man rob God? Malachi 3:8. You say, how have I robbed God? By not bringing your tithes and offerings. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and I will pour out a blessing that you cannot contain. Malachi 3:10. And they preach that, you know, they say, well, we don't follow the Old Testament, but when it comes to tithing, they slip in those Old Testament passages on you. And so now you forked over the tithe. You didn't really want to give it, but you forked it over at 10%. And then they had the building fund, or we're sending a missionary somewhere. You know, we're going to have missionaries going over to Africa. So then you end up giving them that. And you get some churches nowadays, they don't just take one offering. They take two or three offerings on a Sunday morning. Well, this offering here is a love offering for our pastor. This offering is for the missionaries that we're going to send over to Somalia. This offering here is for the building fund. This offering here is just your regular offering, tithes and offering. And like, you keep taking money out. And so you paid all this, and then you get to the restaurant, it's like, man, especially guys, you know, we're like this, and which is good, because you need to budget your money. I mean, you can't just give away money based on emotion, because then you don't have any money to pay your bills. So then the guy looks at his wallet and says, a lot less money in here than I thought there would be because of all those offerings that were taken. And or even if I just gave the 10%, or I just gave money to in an offering, it's like, well, I already gave what I need. You know, I feel like I need to cut back. So all of a sudden, they cut back on the tip there. So the way they look like, they represent Christ by them dressing up, showing they came from church, you know, looking nice. And of course they used God's name. Oh yeah, I just been to church. Oh, it was a great message. Well, what was it about? Well, I don't remember what the pastor spoke about, but it was really good, whatever he said. And I just felt the presence of the Lord in the worship service. It was just great. Oh, it was just really a blessing to be a Christian. I just thank God for saving me. He's just so good to me. God is good all the time. And you know, they start talking like this to the waitress, and the waitress is thinking, well, yeah, while you were out having fun, I was slaving away here, running back and forth like a chicken with their head cut off. You know, when am I going to get paid for this? You know, because you go to work Monday through Friday, and you make money, so I got to make money myself, and you make more money than me because you're able to have Sunday off, and I don't have Sunday off. I got to work as a waitress. You know, this is what the waitress is thinking. So then, and they know the person's a Christian because all the Christianese they've been talking about. Oh yeah, the Lord's so good. Oh, he's blessing. You know, Jesus is wonderful and all this. And then it comes time for the paying the bill, and they just give a 10% tip. And it's like, well, what kind of message did you just send? You separated yourself as a Christian. You act better than them. And then when it comes time for you to really show who you are, give out of be a cheerful giver, you end up giving less than what they need. You say, well, you know, the pastor only gets 10%, so I'm going to only give the wages 10%. not recognizing it's a completely different situation. You're giving 10% of a $20 bill, and they're giving, and at the church, you're giving 10% of a, you know, $1,000 paycheck. You know, it's a big difference at the end there. And so what ends up happening then is you end up being a bad example, is the point. Here are the Christians who are supposed to allow Christ's love to come through them and have the sound doctrine built up in the inner man, and instead they're doing just the opposite. They've said that they're Christians, so now the waitress is going to say, you know, attach their behavior to this is what a Christian is like, and then they act like they're better than everybody else, and then they are actually worse than everybody else in how they treat the waitress. And remember, we're supposed to be just the opposite. A Christian isn't somebody who is better than anybody else. It's actually just the opposite. Say you've got two people that behave in exact the same manner, and one person trusts in Jesus, recognizes their sinner, trusts in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for their sins. So now they're saved. Then the other person doesn't do that, and they just continue doing what they do. Well, the person who is a Christian should be more humble because they're the ones who recognize that they're a sinner and in need of a Savior. And so when they come into the restaurant, they should recognize, even though they are seated with Christ in heavenly places, they have eternal life, they should be recognizing that because they recognize their sin and their need for a Savior, then they should have a humble attitude all the time. They shouldn't ever think that they're better than anybody else. Even though they are blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, their attitude should be, I'm a sinner. I don't deserve any good. Every good thing I've got, every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights. He's the one who gave it to me. I didn't earn it on my own. So why should I act like I'm better than everybody else because I went to church? Going to church wasn't some torture that I went. Shouldn't be some torture I went through for the Lord, giving Him 1 hour of my week just so I could party up and do whatever I want to justify my sin the rest of the week. Going to church is just, number one, it's gratitude for what God has done for me, and number two, it's a way for me to learn more scripture so that the Word of God can renew my mind, transform me into exhibiting the fruits of the Spirit. Where is the love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, faith, and temperance in a person who acts better than the other person and won't act as well, thinks they're better than everybody else and acts that way, but yet doesn't really demonstrate it through the love of Christ. it's not there. So the Christian, in this case, two people, one person saved, the other person not. The saved person should be more humble and more loving to everybody else, because they're the ones that have the love of Christ. The other one doesn't have that. They're the ones that can walk in the Spirit. The other one can't do it. They're the ones who have recognized that they're a sinner, and only the only good things that come in their life are because of the Lord, while the other person just continues to do what they do. So it shows where the attitude should be, but yet the Christians act just the opposite. And then, you know, aside from the restaurant thing and the Sunday thing, just the rest of the week, as I mentioned, a lot of times they'll even engage in more sin because they justify it by them going to church. The typical example is the guy who gets drunk on Saturday night. You know, if you've ever noticed, and people will make jokes about this, but you look at Catholics, as a whole, Catholics drink more alcohol than other people. And you may think, you know, why that is. Well, they do have wine in their communion, but, you know, that's just a little sip. It's not much. The main reason is because of their religion is so works-based. And so the idea is, here's a person, now they want to go get drunk on a Saturday night. But let's say you got two different people. One person's unsaved, they're not going to church, and the other person claims to be a Christian and they're going to go to church. So the unsaved person looks at it and they say, yeah, I'd like to go get drunk on Saturday night, but, you know, what's my wife going to think about that? You know, I'm an old drunk, I'm not spending time with her, I'm not taking care of things, maybe I'm flirting with girls at the bar, you know, she may be thinking this, she doesn't know. So, you know, for the sake of my marriage, so I can get through the rest of the week here, the weekend here, before I go to work on Monday, since I'm spending all weekend with my wife, well, then I guess I better not go to the bar. Or if I go, I'm not going to stay that long. Or if I go, I'll take a drink or two. I won't get drunk, you know. Or maybe I won't go to the bar and I'll just stay at home and spend time with my wife, but I have a beer or two. You know, that's the attitude of the person who does not go to church. But the person who does go to church, they're thinking, usually when it comes to church, at least nowadays, it's the wife who cons or convinces the husband to go to church with her and to get all the kids. You know, we gotta set a good example for the kids. We want the kids to grow up to be good moral people. We don't want them to go to jail. So let's bring the kids to church, and we gotta be good examples for them. So what the guy says, okay, well, I know I gotta go to church because my wife wants me to go. That's something I really don't want to do, so I'm not going to enjoy Sunday morning anyway. And I'm already going to please the wife by going to church. So if I can go to the bar on Saturday night and drink a little more than I would, and my wife won't complain as much because I'll go to church on Sunday, and I make up for it then. And then I'm still a good example to my kids, because they went to bed and I went to the bar later on. They didn't notice what I did, and they're not going to know the next day, and they think I'm good because I'm going to church, so I'm a good Christian person, and I dressed up and I acted nice in church. And plus, it eases my guilty conscience of committing the sin of getting drunk, or, you know, whatever it was that I did that Saturday night. And so, but that's okay because I went to church and I put in my time with God. So now God is pleased with me. He's forgiven me. I said the rosaries or the Hail Marys or whatever I needed to do. And plus, I'm not really going to enjoy my Sunday morning anyway, because I'm going to endure what that pastor says up there, or that priest. I don't really care about that anyway. So it's better that I'm just zonked out of my mind with this hangover, so that I don't realize how boring it is and how much I'm hating what I'm going through. So why not drink a couple extra beers the night before? They may not go through that entire thought process, but at least subconsciously, there's some justification as to why they do what they do. And remember Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. So your flesh is desperately wicked, so desperate that it will go to church in order to do the bad things it really wants to do. And so what ends up happening now is the Christian, or the person who goes to a Christian church, is doing more of the world and doing more sinful things than the person who stayed at home Saturday night and stayed at home on Sunday morning. Because Sunday morning they did something they enjoyed. Maybe they read the paper, or they slept in, or they, who knows, had breakfast with friends, or whatever they enjoy doing. Go out and play tennis or something. Who knows? Whatever is fun for them, they got to do something fun. Well, they didn't want to be hung over and zonked out of their mind for that, so they made sure they weren't drunk the night before. But the person who went to church, they did not want to go to church. So they, they drank one or two extra the night before, so they didn't have to feel the pain of the preacher on Sunday morning as much. So you can see there how it works. Well, then the rest of the week, Monday through Friday or whatever, again, the flesh is desperately wicked and is deceitful. And so if you're a Christian, you're doing something, going to church, that you don't want to do. And so then your flesh justifies that by saying, well, then I can do whatever I want to do the rest of the week because I serve the Lord, I endured for God. And so then that just carries over to the rest of the week. So then on Monday they go to work. It's like, man, everybody else got 2 days to do what they wanted to do. I only got one day because Sunday I had to put up with the kids and the wife, and then I had to go to church and listen to all that. Then I had to dress up. I had to act all nice afterwards. So now you've got a miserable attitude going into Monday. It's like, I didn't get to rest any. I didn't get to do what I wanted, to watch the football game, but I didn't get to do much of that because I had to go to church and go to lunch. And then afterward, there was the late football game I wanted to watch, but then my wife made me do this or that. And, if I didn't go to church, I could have done whatever I needed to do around the house, mow the lawn or take out the trash or fix something in the garage, do that. I could have done that instead of going to church, and then I could have watched a football game. But now, since I missed a football game by going to church and going to lunch, now I gotta spend the time with the second football game doing this other stuff. So now I'm grumpy going into Monday. I didn't get to do what I wanted to do on Sunday. Now I gotta spend the next 5 days doing a job that I don't want to do, putting up with people I don't like. This is the attitude. I'm not saying that this is what I do. I'm just saying this is the attitude of the person, typical attitude, somebody goes to church. So now they go to work, and now they have a tremendous opportunity to share Christ's love with others, because now they're among unsaved people. Or even if they're among saved people, they can act differently, and so that those people may come to the knowledge of the truth and they can see Christ living in them. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. So here we are, Christ living in us, and we allow Him come through us so that others may be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. And yet the Christian, or the person who went to church, acts worse throughout the whole week as a result of what he had to do on Sunday when he didn't want to do it. And then if anything comes up where, they ask him about your behavior or something, it's like you can justify your behavior by saying you're a Christian. It's like sin is okay because now I go to church. Or they don't even realize that they're acting worse than everybody else. And they don't really have an example of someone who does have Christ living in them, because the people who do go to church, they don't learn sound doctrine, and they don't read their Bibles. And if they do read their Bibles, they don't learn sound doctrine because they don't know how to understand it, because they're listening to what religion told them rather than just believing what the Bible says itself. And so you don't have the examples of other Christians where Christ is living in them. So then the person who goes to church looks at how everybody else behaves who goes to church and sees, well, they're just behaving just like I am. And they think that they're somehow better, even though their behavior is worse due to them having to endure going to church. And so then they behave worse, thinking they're better. Then they talk about God, or they'll set up these arbitrary rules that somehow make them better. And that's the idea of relative truth, where what Christians normally do, Christianity as a whole, what they do is they take whatever the morals are of the society as a whole, and they add one or two things to them to make themselves appear better. So like 100 years ago, Prohibition. Oh, well, I'm a good Christian. I don't drink. You know, they do everything else, but oh no, I don't drink. So somehow I'm better. You know, I take a stand. Or in the 50s or 60s, you know, free love. Oh no, I don't condone that. You know, sex only within marriage. Again, good things, you know, not drinking and confining sex to marriage, good things. But using them as an excuse for bad behavior. That I'm somehow better than everybody else because of my views on abortion, for example. You know, abortion, that's killing babies. I don't go for that. That's not what a good Christian does. So then, when you have the office, the water cooler conversations at the office, the Christian stands up and says, oh, don't take God's name in vain, or oh, don't curse, or I guess you say it's a woman's right to choose, but I don't agree with that. You know, it's killing, and as a good Christian, I don't stand for anything like that. That's murder. You know, so here you are trying to impose your rules on the rest of the office, and somehow by you having just a step ahead in your morality, you think you're somehow better than everybody else, and everybody else says, well, they're just as wicked as I am. They do the same things I do. The only difference is they go to church for an hour on Sundays. That's the only difference. And here they act like they're better than me. I don't want to have anything to do with Christianity. The attitude of the Christian shouldn't be, I'm better than everybody else. The attitude should be, I'm a sinner. And sure, God has saved me. He's given me the gift of eternal life, and I'm seated together with Christ in heavenly places, and I'm being blessed there. But I'm still in my vile flesh, Philippians 3:21. I'm not any better than anybody else. The only difference is I've allowed God through His grace to bless me. And it's the same thing with your Bible knowledge, allowing the Scripture, the Holy Spirit, to teach it to you. Again, it doesn't mean I'm smarter than everybody else because I know more Scripture. It's because I have the Holy Spirit to teach it to me, and I just allowed Him to do so. That's all it is. So, but that attitude of a little better morality, so I'm better than everybody else, you know, I don't curse, or I don't do this or that. You know, nowadays, we're coming up in the season to Lent. You know, yeah, I'm a good person because for 40 days I pledged not to eat chocolate, or 40 days I'm going to pray every night, or 40 days, you know, whatever it is that they do for Lent. Again, it's just an observation. It's just a ceremony to make me look better than everybody else. And so I make this video to warn you. Now, I'm thinking at the same time, you know, when you are a Christian, you should have the better morality. You should believe abortion is a sin, and premarital sex is a sin, and you know, getting drunk is a sin. And you should believe all those things. I'm not counting against that. But what I'm saying is you don't use that as an excuse for pride to make yourself better than everybody else, but rather those decisions that you make not to curse or not to get drunk or not to participate in the things of the world isn't to make you look like you're a better person or to make you look good in the eyes of God, but it's out of recognizing who you are in Christ and allowing the sound doctrine to work in you, and you do it not to look better, but so that you may share Christ's love with everybody else. You don't put it in front of their face and flaunt it. That's just who you are. And believe me, they'll pick up on it. They'll notice. They'll notice the difference. And then you have the opportunity, because you didn't flaunt it in their face, and you have the opportunity to share Christ with them. And then when they say, well, I know Christians, they don't act like you. And then you say, well, you know, I don't belong to a church, or I'm not a denominational person. I just believe God and His Word. They're just an example of what man says, but I'm an example of what God's Word says. And God's Word truly can make you a better person and transform your life if you just believe the gospel. See, and you have that opportunity. So thank you for joining us for Candid Conversation number 13.